Order the April 6th meeting of the Verona Plan Commission. We will begin with the roll call, please. Mr. Sarah?
Commissioner Manley?
Here.
Alderperson Linder?
Here.
Commissioner Turk?
Here.
Mayor Hokumer?
Here.
Commissioner Horsfall?
Here.
Commissioner Lytle?
Here.
Commissioner Heinzen?
Here.
We do have a quorum. We have everyone present this evening. Thank you very much for that. Next on the agenda, we have approval of minutes from the March 7th meeting of the Plan Commission. And those minutes were included with your packet. What's your pleasure? We have a motion by Mr. Linder. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Manley. Were there any additions or corrections to the minutes of the previous meeting? Seeing none, all those in favor of the approval of minutes signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carried, and the minutes are approved. Next, we have a public hearing on a conditional use permit amendment for Hop House Brewing Company to allow an outdoor patio with seating to be located at 231 South Main Street. Do I have a motion to open the public hearing? We have a motion by Mr. Horsfall. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Lytle. All those in favor of opening the public hearing signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried. We are in the public hearing stage. Mr. Sarah, if you would provide the background, please.
Thank you. Hop House is requesting a conditional use permit amendment to allow outdoor seating at their property at 231 South Main Street. This request requires a public hearing before the Plan Commission, and the Plan Commission will make a recommendation to the Common Council on this item.
Thank you, Mr. Sarah. With that, we are in the public hearing stage for this agenda item. Is there anyone from the public that wishes to speak on this agenda item? Is there anyone from the public that wishes to speak? Anyone from the public that wishes to speak on this agenda item? Seeing none, I would accept the motion to close the public hearing. We have a motion by Mr. Manley. Is there a second?
I'll
second. Seconded by Mr. Heinzen. All in favor of closing the public hearing signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carried. Next we have discussion and possible action regarding the conditional use permit amendment for the Hop House Brewing Company. Mr. Sarah, if you would, please.
Thank you. Once again, Hop House is requesting a outdoor seating area just north of their building. Their property is highlighted in yellow on the screen. The outdoor seating area would come off the corner of the property or the building approximately in this location. Hop House was granted a conditional use permit in 2014 for the operation of their business. They've been in business approximately 1 year, and it has become a draw for the downtown area. Based upon that, the applicant is looking at expanding an outdoor creating an outdoor seating area. This was his initial intent when he initially came forward back in 2014. I think on the advice of staff was to kind of wait till the business was established so we would have a better understanding of the operations, which I think are pretty clear now since he's been open for a year. No additional parking is planned with this project. The applicant is looking at fencing or putting the fence up in this location. The blue line is just to represent the location of the fence. It's not the size, it's not the style, obviously, but just to show where it would go. As part of the project, the applicant would fill in this garden area, which I don't think has any flowers in it at all anymore. I think it's just grass and weeds. They would also eliminate this curb cut that's currently here that goes nowhere, and then they would extend the fence all the way to the dumpster. The main sidewalk in front of the building is the sidewalk that runs right through here where the cursor is, and it comes up to Railroad Street where there is a curb cut for a handicap crossing and pedestrian crossing as well. So this curb cut here actually serves no purpose at all. So the fence the applicant is looking at is a decorative black fence. It'd be similar to what you see in the downtown, what you see outside of City Hall here as well. It'd be 48 inches tall. It would have the kind of the circle kind of rings that you see on it, typical of the downtown fencing. The exit, there need to be an emergency exit for the patio, and that would be off the corner here. It's required by code that exit has to have a push bar on it, so there'd be a push bar on that. And there'd also be an alarm on that as well for the police department to meet the liquor license requirements. So the gate would be alarmed, so if someone walked through it, the alarm would go off and the bartenders would be alerted that someone has opened the gate and is by accident or is attempting to leave the patio area. Access to the site normally would just be from the second door on the property. There are two doors right now. This is the main principal access point on the south side of the elevation. Staff is recommending hours of operations for this establishment, or for the outside area, which would include 9 p.m., the maximum, or cutting off at 9 p.m. during the week and 10 p.m. on the weekends. That is consistent with other types of outdoor areas, such as Gray's Tide House, that are adjacent to residential areas. Staff has shared this with the applicant, and he has no concerns with that. The applicant has also indicated he may install some additional type of festive lighting out there, similar to what the Classic has as well. Staff doesn't have any issues with that, and we'll work with the applicant on the lighting to make sure it meets all our requirements. As part of this application, the applicant will need to amend their liquor license to extend the premise. Tentatively, that will go to public safety on April 11th. Regarding the downtown plan and looking at how this is consistent with the request, the goal of the downtown plan is to create a vibrant destination for residents and visitors. The downtown plan does not specifically discuss or recommend on patios, except it does state that they should be permitted to the sidewalk. The request by the applicant is consistent with the goal and the recommendation of that plan. Further, the Hop House property is located within downtown design and use overlay district, and the goal of that district once again is to create a vibrant and attractive commercial downtown. The requirements of the district state patios, gardens, seating areas, and similar features are encouraged in the front yards. So once again, looking at an outdoor seating area in this location is consistent with the overlay district. One item that I should note is that currently there are bike racks in the location of the outdoor seating area. The applicant would relocate those to the south side of the property where there are additional bike racks already. Staff did go through the general and specific findings of facts, and we do recommend that the Plan Commission recommend to the Common Council approval of the conditional use permit amendment to allow Hop House Brewing Company to add an outdoor patio with seating at 231 South Main with the following conditions. One, the outdoor patio fencing shall be a minimum of 48 inches tall. Two, alcohol consumption shall be limited to the fenced area as shown on the site plan or inside the brewery. All areas where alcohol is consumed shall be monitored by staff. Three, the fence and gate for the outdoor patio shall comply with the requirements from the police department and building inspector. Four, the exit for the patio shall be labeled as exit only. And five, the use of the outdoor seating area is permitted to operate from 7 a.m. to 9 p.m. Sunday through Thursday, and from 7 a.m. to 10 p.m. Friday and Saturday. And those conditions are consistent with the conditions that we placed on Treads and other businesses that have outdoor seating areas. So with that, that completes my report. I know the applicant is here tonight, and he'd be happy to answer any questions that I can't answer. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. With that, if there's any questions, comments, or potential motions, if we were to take action this evening, it would be a recommendation to the Common Council. Questions, comments, potential motions? Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Adam, one of the conditions of the conditional use permit would be compliance with requirements of the police department and the building inspector. Do you know if the chief of police or his staff have reviewed this proposal and kind of signed off on it in terms of, you said it was consistent with what we've had at other establishments? I know we've, in the past, we've had a couple of hiccups with, we had different heights allowed at different establishments, and I think we've tried, and I think have successfully tried to get that to be more uniform. Now is that,
Mr. Sheriff, please?
Yeah, the 48 inches is the height that is what the police department would like to see. I think the language for the fence and gate is kind of, the fence and gate for the outdoor patio shall comply with the requirements from the police department and building inspector. It's kind of a catch-all that I'm using in there. I know the building inspector has said there has to be a gate on it, and it has to have the push bar to it. The police department goes back to the alarm system as well too, so that's kind of trying to catch all those. I know the police chief has looked at it. I talked to him about it the other day. I think in general he's comfortable with it. I think it still has to go to public safety for that ultimate approval, and ultimately the council as well. But the impression I've gotten from him that is I think it's something he can get behind. The only comment I think he raised to me of his concern was it is close to the roadway, so he did have some potential concerns of it being that close to the road. I'm not sure if that's going to factor into his decision at all, but he did leave me the impression that he wasn't raising a big issue with that. It just was a concern.
Thank you.
Any other, Mr. Lytle, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Do you know off the top of your head, Adam, how the hours of the outdoor patio coincide or don't with the operating hours of the establishment?
Mr. Sir?
I guess I'll defer to Phil on that one.
If you would, for not only our benefit, but those watching at home, if you would introduce yourself, please.
Sure. Phil Hoekst, the owner and brewmaster at Hop House Brewing Company.
Welcome.
Thank you. So the question is how the hours coincide. So during the week, we're generally open until 10. That's our posted time is 10 o'clock. And then weekends, we're open until 11. So I guess it would be an hour difference. And we'd be open an hour longer inside than we would outside.
Do you foresee any issues with getting people ushered back inside? I mean, I assume you can't lock that door because it's still an exit door. So
right.
You sort of have to, I mean, it seems like it's more of an operational issue than anything, but I assume.
Right, no, I think our plan is to, obviously our staff's gonna know the hours, but post the hours, I'm trying to figure out if we can do it on both sides of that door that goes out to the patio, because that's really the only entrance and exit to the patio, I mean, other than the emergency one. I think posting it there, I think will be good, but also, I mean, when we're first open, probably letting people know when we're open or how long. So I'm just inviting them back inside.
And then hope they stay there.
They'll stay there.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Other questions, comments? Mr. Horsfall, please.
Yeah, just looking at the picture that's on the screen, there's lights on the, would be the west side. Are there lights on the north side?
That
where the bike racks are.
Right, the ones that are over it, there's actually, I guess there's outlets for them okay. That you could put those gooseneck ones in if you wanted to sign. But I think instead we've talked to the electrician is actually running an outlet down to put, like, we haven't decided if they're going to be the overhead, like the, I don't want to call them festival lights, but like the, you know, like the ones you can string up either over the top of the seating area or just around the perimeter along the fence. So we'll have a little bit of lighting out there, but there's no overhead like shining lights that are down on there right now.
So does that area, from your experience, is that pretty dark when it turns, you know?
No, actually there, the major light is actually coming from across the way, which is from plumbing.
Light.
Well, there's plumbing, there's street light and there's plumbing
okay.
Glass has like a, I don't know if it's a security light, but they've got a light that's on that dumpster that's
okay,
pretty bright.
Okay, so there's plenty of light on that side of the building. Okay. And follow another question. On the picture that was provided, what is the distance between the edge of the building and the fence? That's right there. Do you guys know what that is? And is there a requirement that it has to be a certain more than 4 feet? 5 feet, 6 feet, looks kind of like 6 feet.
Mr. Sir?
I want to say it's between about 6 or 8, that
yeah,
is my guess.
So that exact dimension from that farthest corner over, I can certainly easily measure. I don't know off the top of my head what that distance is, that little corner piece.
And I'm more worried, is there an issue with that having to be a certain size to have, not pedestrian, but, you know, access from the back area to the other area?
Yeah, I know the building inspector met with you on site. I think you guys talked about it. I don't recall that issue coming up.
No, I think
accessibility standpoint in the patio, I don't recall that issue.
Certainly moving like those bike racks, which take up probably 2 feet, 2.5 maybe. Those are gonna be out of there along that north window. But yeah, I don't know off the top of my head exactly how far. I'd say at least 6 feet, maybe farther.
My guess would be 6 to 8.
And I'm just trying to make sure that somebody's looked at it to make sure there's always kind of access. If it's more than whatever the requirement is, that, I mean, maybe the requirement's only 4 feet for that. And I just didn't know what that dimension was. And I just wanted to,
yeah.
You know, you say you're going to have 6 tables, and I was trying to figure out where the tables would be and then trying to
right, yeah,
figure
and
out.
And that, yeah, like, I guess our number is like 4 to 8, depending on if they're two tops, like little tiny tables with just 2 chairs, or if we're putting bigger ones in the back. So that's one of the things that we've kind of looked at, but we haven't
finalized.
We didn't commit because we wanted approval first.
Okay.
So yeah, I think that depends once we get the chairs out there to actually figure out where everything's going.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, we're gonna make it just like we do inside, an easily you know, accessible point to get all the way through.
Okay. Yeah. Great. Thank you.
Yeah. Mr. Sayre?
One thing with the lighting as well, we are redoing the streetscaping out there this year, and there is a new light that is planned right in the, off the screen here at the corner, and that's going to probably provide significant lighting for this area as well. So it's going to get brighter.
Is it going to be blue?
No, it's black.
Any other questions or comments? Potential motions? Question, Mr. Manley, please.
I guess if there aren't any more questions, I'll make a motion to recommend approval of the conditional use permit with the conditions as presented.
Okay, we have a motion by Mr. Manley. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Heinzen. Questions or comments on the motion? Questions or comments? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, no. Motion carried. So that will be on the Common Council agenda for next week, Monday.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have a public hearing on a conditional use permit for a proposed indoor commercial entertainment land use known as True Studio to be located at 160 Keenan Court. Do I have a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
We have a motion by Mr. Linder. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Turk. All those in favor of opening the public hearing signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, no. Motion carried. We are in the public hearing stage. Mr. Sayre, if you'd provide the background, please.
Thank you. So once again, we are in a public hearing for a indoor commercial entertainment land use. That does include yoga and fitness studios, which is what True Studio is. By ordinance, the Plan Commission is required to hold a public hearing on this item, and then they make a recommendation to the Common Council. So we are in the public hearing stage, and I'll provide the rest of my report once we come out of this.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. Is there anyone from the public that wishes to speak on this agenda item? Anyone from the public that wishes to speak on this agenda item? Going the third and final time on this one. Seeing no one wanting to speak on this during public hearing, do I have a motion to close the public hearing? We have a motion by Mr. Horsfall. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Heinzen. All those in favor of closing the public hearing signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, no. That motion carries. We are now on agenda item 5A, which is discussion and possible action regarding conditional use permit on the issue that we just talked about. If we were to take an action on item 5A, it would be a recommendation to the Common Council, and on 5B, it's a decision by the Plan Commission. Mr. Sayre, if you'd provide the background again, please.
Thank you. So for ease of discussion, I will combine the report for the conditional use permit and site plan together. Once again, the applicant is requesting a conditional use permit to operate a fitness studio at 160 Keenan Court. Keenan Court is the new street that is just east of the Taco Bell. They're currently constructing a Pizza Ranch restaurant in the front of it. The property in question, or for the conditional use permit and site plan tonight, is the one highlighted in yellow on the screen. Back in 2015, we approved the plans for the Pizza Ranch. We also approved the plans for a smaller retail building just west of the Pizza Ranch on this parcel. And then we also approved a commercial building on the lot in yellow again that was planned for 6,470 square feet. The applicant is here tonight and basically requesting some changes to the facade and also some changes to the size of the building based upon a tenant that they've identified. Specifically, they're looking at facade changes, also looking at increasing the size of the previously improved building to 10,136 square feet. That would include 6,854 square feet on the first floor and approximately 3,200 square feet in the basement. The fitness studio would include cycling and yoga areas. And there's also a small retail area planned for food and beverages. So the facade changes and building size changes, that's a site plan requirement that requires approval from the Plan Commission. And the use itself requires approval from the Common Council. The building itself is orientated very similar to the previously approved building here on Keenan Court. The proposed building does meet all the minimum and maximum setback requirements of the SC zoning district and also of the Downtown Design and Overlay District. Parking is very similar to the previous approved project as well. Parking would be shared with the Pizza Ranch project. There's also a project that is being proposed tonight north of this site as well. Parking with that user as well would be shared with the studio use as well. Access is unchanged from what we previously saw. There'd be two access points from Keenan Court. Staff has no concerns with the parking or the access on the site. A detailed landscaping plan was submitted with the site plan this evening. It is very similar to the plan that was approved in 2015 and meets the minimum point requirements, so staff has no concerns with that landscaping plan. The building itself will contain high quality materials. The applicant is proposing to use stone, brick, ephes, and laminate siding. I can kind of flip through some of these elevations. The east elevation, they've added an outdoor patio and pergola area for seating and also potentially for classes they may be holding out there. Staff has no concerns with the look of the pergola or the outdoor seating. We think it'll add a nice amenity and feature to the site. Access to the site to the outdoor patio will be from sliding doors and also fold-away doors. There's also a roll-up window planned to provide access to the food and beverage area that would be planned within this facility. We have no concerns with that use as well, or the design of that either. In general, I think it's a nice looking building. I think it's gotten better even from the last one that we saw, and it would be a nice addition to this location and to the city. So staff has no concerns with the architecture or the design of the building. Signage is planned for the property. There is a ground sign that is planned for the site approximately in this location. One item that we did raise to the applicant and also to Pizza Ranch was taking a look at a joint monument sign for the entire development. Visibility for these parcels that are located off of Rona Avenue will be very challenging. And speaking with the owner of Pizza Ranch, he was open to the idea. He currently is not planning his own monument sign at this time, but he would be open to some type of joint signage. So I've kind of left that up to the developer and the owner of the Pizza Ranch property if that's something they want to pursue, but staff felt that would be a logical idea for all the development that is occurring kind of off of Keenan Court. So we'll see what comes of that. With any project, we did go through the general and specific findings of facts for the conditional use permit, and it does meet all the requirements. So staff does recommend the Plan Commission recommend the Common Council approval of the conditional use permit to allow True Studio to be located at 160 Keenan Court. And second, staff does recommend the Plan Commission approve the site plan to allow for the construction of a 10,136 square foot commercial building at 160 Keenan Court. The architect is here tonight. I'm sure he'd be happy to answer any questions. I'm also happy to answer any questions you have.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. Again, we are on agenda item 5A, which it would be if we were to take action, a recommendation to the Common Council. Questions or comments from Planning Commission members? Any questions or comments? Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I guess my only comment would be, I think architecturally it looks very nice. I appreciate, you know, the use of different types of materials, a lot of wood, a lot of stone, some metal. I think visually it's an attractive building.
Thank you, Mr. Manley. Mr. Linder, please.
Yeah, I'd like to echo Mr. Manley's. I think it's a nice looking building. I think this is a good spot for the proposed use, and I think it'll make a good addition to the city. So.
Thank you, Mr. Linder. Other comments, questions, potential motions? Mr. Lytle, please.
Thank you. One question quick. Can you remind me, Adam, is there a eventual plan if and when there's coordination with Farm and Fleet Hometown, I forget the name of the property owner there, for Keenan Court to connect with anything, or is this and shall forevermore be a cul-de-sac?
Mr. Sarah, please.
Sure. So the long-term plan of Keenan Court is to have it on the screen here. I'm not sure if Andy has it up, but basically extend Keenan Court, loop it to the south to connect to Hometown Circle when that parcel east of Farm and Fleet develops. When that happens, the access that is currently through the Dane County facility, that would be closed off at that time. So long term, yes, we do plan on extending that. When that happens is a wonderful question that I can't answer.
Thank you. I'll go ahead and make a motion that we recommend approval to the council the conditional use permit for True Studio at 160 Keenan Court.
We have a motion by Mr. Lytle. Is there a second? Second by Mr. Horsfall. Questions or comments on the motion? Questions or comments? Seeing none, all those in favor of recommending approval of the CUP signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried. Now we are on agenda item 5B, which is action is only necessary by the Plan Commission. Questions, comments, potential motions? Mr. Linder, please.
Hey, I'll make a motion to approve the site plan for the law of construction of a 10,136 square foot fitness studio known as True Studio to be located at 160 Keenan Court.
We have a motion by Mr. Linder. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Manley. Questions or comments on that motion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion to approve the site plan signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carried. So the conditional use permit action as a recommendation will be on the Common Council for Monday evening. Thank you. We are now on agenda item number 6, which is discussion and possible action regarding site plan review for Capital Lawn Sprinkler to construct a 1,500 square foot building addition to be located at 636 South Nine Mound Road. And again, this would require Plan Commission action only. Mr. Sayre, please.
Thank you. So Capital Lawn Sprinkler is requesting to expand their building at 636 South Nine Mound Road. The building, just for reference purposes, is located in the yellow highlighted area here. The new Fairfield Inn and Suites is located on that parcel there. The addition would be approximately 1,000 square feet being added to the physical building itself, and the applicant is also proposing a 750 square foot lean-to addition on the east side. Furthermore, the applicant would convert approximately 472 square feet of the existing building to office space. What is driving this addition is the need for additional office space in the building. It's in the city's an older industrial park, so space obviously is at a premium. And I know I've looked at a couple different site plans with the applicant, and I think we finally found one that probably works from a code standpoint. The addition itself does meet all the required setbacks. It would be set back approximately 65 feet from the north property line, 30 feet from the west property line. The lean-to would be set back 5 feet from the east property line. The applicant has obtained a permission from the owner to the east to have a zero lot line with the lean-to. Staff has no concerns with the setback. No additional parking or an access, and the access is not changing to the site as part of this addition, so staff has no concerns. No additional impervious surface is being added to the property, but an erosion control permit would be required for the addition. The building itself is being designed to match the existing structure on the property with kind of the tan siding and also blue roof line and also blue metal at the base. Staff has no concerns with the changes. The north elevation would contain three windows on it as part of the expansion. They would also be adding an additional overhead door as part of the addition too. This is the view looking towards the south. This is the north side of the addition. Staff has no concerns with it. It's a property that's located within the industrial park, and it fits with the surrounding buildings. So that staff does recommend the Plan Commission waive the initial review for the proposed building addition and approve the site plan for Capital Lawn Sprinkler at 636 South Nine Mound Road with the following condition: that prior to the issuance of building permits, the applicant shall submit a grading and erosion control plan for approval by the city engineer. I know the applicant is here tonight. I'm sure he'd be happy to answer any questions you have.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. Questions or comments? You've heard the explanation by Mr. Sayre. Again, this is a site plan review and requires Plan Commission action only. Questions or comments? Mr. Horsfall, please.
So, Adam, how does it work when the neighbor agrees that it's a 4 foot or a zero lot line? Does there have to be a CSA or
CSA? Mr. Yeah. Sayre, please.
So the code isn't clear on what exactly is required for that. I know the applicant has obtained written permission from the owner in writing stating they have no objection to a setback that is closer than what is allowed by code. It still would be set back approximately 5 feet from the lot line. So it's not on the lot line, but it is that 5 foot setback still to provide that buffer. But the code isn't clear on exactly what is specifically required for that. So I think from my interpretation, a written permission I think was sufficient. Ultimately it's not zero, so we aren't touching each other, but we do have that permission in writing signed by the owner.
If I may add, there is 20 feet.
If you wouldn't mind, come to the podium, and then those that are watching at home can hear as well.
I am Don Delk. I'm the co-owner, operator. There is 20 feet
off of the building to the east as well, coming my way. So there will still be a 25-foot buffer in between the two buildings.
And I'm not really worried about that. I'm just worried about 20 years down the road when somebody else buys that property, and if that piece of paper gets lost, mm-hmm. and the guy says, well, why is that guy so close to my property? And is there a way to kind of make it formalized, or do you have records of that? Or that's more of what I'm getting at.
Sure. Mr. Sir?
Yeah, I guess 20 years, we should still have the file. Hopefully that we've scanned them in. They're digital by that 50. Point. 50 years. I mean, I think what we're going to have is we have the letter that we have kind of showing it. We have the minutes from the meeting tonight saying the Planning Commission has kind of addressed it. I think in looking at the lean-to as well, it's not a full-scale building addition as well, too. So, I mean, I think there is potential at some point if you were ever to move out of there, somebody might just come in and go, I don't want that in the building anyway. So. But no, we would have that with the minutes and with that letter and with the report. I think we have sufficient documentation to back this up, that it was approved by the city. It was authorized by the property owner at the time. And anyone purchasing either this property or that property is going to see there's an addition there and say, what happened? And we can produce the documentation.
So let me back up a little bit. This is zoned
urban industrial.
And then setbacks on urban industrial are what?
For a side yard setback, it's 10 feet for a building. Unless it's a zero lot line, then it's zero.
So you see where my little confusion is, that we're kind of not violating, but we're going against whatever the zoning is in this area. And there has to be some kind of exception shown somewhere. And rather than just a letter, it seems, I don't know. It seems like we're missing something a little bit versus, you know, a letter saying property owner A says property owner B can be that close to the lot line.
Mr. Sayre?
We could probably have some attorneys get involved and draft up some language and have an agreement in place that could potentially be recorded on the properties. I mean, if there's a concern that legally it's not, I'm not sure if Mr. Heinzen has a comment on that, but.
Jump in here for just a moment just to suggest that the owner who is giving the permission, if that agreement is not recorded, I would have some concern the purchaser of the neighbor would not have noticed that this ordinance wasn't being complied with. So,
thank you, Mr. Heinzen.
One thing with the ordinance, it is being complied with. It does allow a zero lot line. It's the how you facilitate that, I think, is the question. I just want to make sure we're clear on that. The ordinance does say you can go down to a zero lot line. So it is conforming what the ordinance says. Now, the ordinance is not clear on the process of how that is put into place.
But I thought you said zoning-wise, it has to be a 10-foot.
10 feet unless it is explicitly called a zero lot line. But the ordinance doesn't say how a zero lot line is brought up, how it's enforced. Oh. It just references that you can have a zero lot line, but there is no procedure in place to say this is how you do a zero lot line. So that's the gray area of how you establish a zero lot line. I would agree with Mr. Heinzen that definitely the clear way, if there's any confusion about this, we could have a simple agreement probably drafted up between the two parties to have it recorded on the property, and that would be sufficient, I think, with the action tonight and that agreement.
Yeah. Understanding since we built the building that there was room there to go that way, but we would need permission from the neighbor to do that. Now, I don't know, you know, what the document is or what the protocol is on that, but I've always kind of been under the impression that what we did was kind of the correct protocol to do that, you know, to make that happen.
Questions, comments, potential motions? Mr. Linder, please.
Just to wrap that up, do we need to have that as part of a amended motion to, or included in a motion to have some sort of legal document written up between the two?
Mr. Sayers?
I think if there's a concern from the Planning Commission, I would recommend that. And it should be a pretty simple document that your attorney or her attorney as well could possibly just, it's not a complicated document by any means. It's mostly just acknowledging it's a zero lot line. She'd be authorizing you to do that. But it's something the city wouldn't want to review it, but if you want to require that, that's fine by me. But you can check with the applicant as well.
Mr. Heinzen?
I was just going to say, I guess agree with you, Mr. Sayre, that I think that this is more of a concern for the two property owners than it is for the city.
I'm just worried about future potential property owners and this getting missed. Somebody pissed off about it.
So. Any other questions, comments, or potential motions? Any questions, comments, motions? Mr. Horsfall?
At this time, I'd like to approve, have the Plan Commission approve the site plan for Capital Lawn Sprinkler at 636 South Nine Mound Road with the following condition that's detailed in the report.
We do have a motion by Mr. Horsfall. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Heinzen. Questions or comments on the motion? Mr. Linder?
Do we have to say anything about waiving initial review at all or no?
Do we?
Sure. You want
to waive the initial review.
Add that to the motion. And Mr. Heinzen, that has been added. Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. And that motion is carried.
Thank you,
General. Thank you. Agenda item number 7. This will be a no action item for the Planning Commission this evening. This is discussion and discussion on initial review site plan review and conditional use permit review of a proposed 9,400 square foot group daycare center to be located at 200 Keenan Court. Mr. Sayre, if you would please.
Thank you. So once again, we are back in the area behind the Pizza Ranch along Keenan Court. The property in question tonight is the one highlighted in yellow. The applicant is requesting an initial review of a proposed daycare facility that'd be located on the east side of this property. The building itself, there was a conceptual site plan provided in the submittal. I will point out that the building shown on the west here is just conceptual only, just to kind of help lay out the parking lot of how this is kind of being laid out jointly with the potential for an additional building in the future. The daycare building, though, would be set back 24 feet from Keenan Court, and it does meet the required side and rear yard setbacks as well. Staff has no concerns with the building setbacks or the building location. There would be an outdoor play area for the children on the east side of the property. The height of the building is approximately 22 feet and does conform to the minimum height requirements of the downtown overlay district. The applicant is proposing 81 parking spaces for the project. 43 are required by the zoning ordinance. Daycare land uses require one parking space per 5 students plus one space for each employee on the largest shift. So parking would be provided on the north of the property and also on the west. This parking lot would also be shared with the fitness studio that would be located to the south. That's just off the screen here. Because of that, one recommendation from staff, if the project does move forward, is to install a public sidewalk right in front of the stormwater pond here, so we can connect with this kind of curb cut for the sidewalk on the south side of the street. It'll provide better connectivity and also just make it safer for people crossing the road and using this shared facility. Conceptual stormwater was provided on the site plan. Initially, the applicant is proposing two ponds on the property. Staff has no initial concerns with that, but we'll need to see the stormwater details before the project can go forward. Conceptual landscaping plans are also provided in the submittal. Of note is the applicant is proposing a significant amount of landscaping along the east property line here to help screen the outdoor play area from the Dane County facility. Staff has no concerns with that. The applicant is also proposing a metal fence that would be installed around the outdoor play area. This would be a typical black wrought iron type fence that you see elsewhere in the city. Staff has no concerns with the fence design. The building itself, from a design and architectural standpoint, the applicant is proposing to use fiber cement siding and stone veneer. Covered porches have been included along the south and west elevations. Ample windows are provided because it is a daycare use. The Planning Commission is encouraged to review the building designs and provide feedback to the applicant. The architect is here tonight. I'm sure he'd be happy to answer any questions you have. But staff does recommend the Planning Commission review the submitted materials and provide feedback to the applicant.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. Questions or comments, feedback from Planning Commission members? Any feedback you'd like to offer, Mr. Lytle, please?
This isn't particularly site plan related, but is this the same applicant that had come forward previously with a potential facility on West Verona Avenue?
My understanding is yes, and that property obviously was not acquired by the owner. It was acquired by a different individual who I believe is in the process of remodeling that, and last I heard they were putting a contractor type office in there with a showroom for, you know, as a construction person with a showroom. But yes, this is this, my understanding it's the same person who did look at that property in West Verona Avenue.
Okay, wasn't sure if suddenly Verona was popping up with daycares everywhere or not. Thank you.
Comments, additional feedback? Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I guess the, you know, maybe the primary observation I had with respect to this project was architecturally looking at this building and then thinking about the building that we just reviewed for the fitness studio, and thinking about the other buildings that are out in that sort of larger Farm and Fleet development area. To my eye, this is, from a design standpoint, it's just quite not consistent with what's out there, and I just thought I'd point that out. Don't know if there's agreement that, you know, maybe there's some things that could be done to change it and have it fit in a little bit better, but I just wanted to provide that input.
Thank you, Mr. Manley. Other comments, other feedback? Mr. Linder, please.
Yeah, Mr. Manley, exactly my thought, you know, just seems like they're quite a bit different, and not sure how it'll look as far as a complete development goes. And the other thing I was aesthetically, it looks like, you know, the south and north elevations are, you know, I think are look all right, but then the west and the east has a lot of roof line, and it just looks kind of, to me, just looks kind of plain. Typically, I would like to see some little more aesthetically pleasing, I guess. As far as the, you know, location and stuff, and that I have no issues with, just kind of the way the building looks.
Thank you. Other comments? Mr. Lytle, please.
I imagine the applicant will have maybe some responses. I think what we could do is look at somehow sort of transitioning from the Dane County facility that's to the east back towards Farm and Fleet, which is to the west, as well as the fitness studio. So I would hope that we could take bits from both to create that transition, because it seems like it's much more in use separate and back from East Verona Avenue. But I agree that there's probably some improvements that could be made.
Thank you, Mr. Lytle. Jerry, if you wish to. Again, Jerry, we know you, but for the benefit of those watching, if you would introduce yourself, please.
Okay. I'm Jerry Berkwin, and I'm with Dimension 4 Architects in Madison. We're the project architect. On some of the items addressed on the appearances, be quite honest, some of it is a little intentional, because actually this is more of a daycare, and we're kind of looking for, you know, parents and children and want them to be comfortable. So we're looking at something that had a little bit of residential, not a pure commercial feel to it, so that was kind of more of that comfort level. I think there's things we can do on some of the materials and stuff to kind of break up the roof or whatever. But we're intentionally trying to keep this in a little different character than, say, the more the straight commercial buildings, which are on the other sides. And I think we've got a great opportunity here with, you know, kind of facing off onto the parkland toward the east and the bike trail. So we're trying to get a good blend on what's happening in that portion. But there was an intentional push to kind of get a little bit of residential character just for what the nature of this building is and nature of what we're going to do in the building.
Thank you. Any other questions that we might have for Jerry, as long as he's up there? Mr. Linder?
Yeah, did you ever have thoughts of putting it where the future building is instead? Is it not big enough there? I mean, is you're talking about transitioning to the area behind it with the park and
yeah, kind of the bike trail. And yeah, the other one is actually this way, we're catching kind of the east and the morning sun coming into our play area then for our children then too. So we've got kind of them in a nice area there that's kind of separated, say, from the commercial or from the parking lot from the other portions. So we're intentionally doing it that way to kind of get that morning sun and give them kind of a separate play area along that side. Kind of extension of the park.
Thank you.
I will say we are going to be right back after this, because we're right back in your next agenda, because we're looking actually to get this open by like August. So which that means they've already compressed the schedule a little too far, but you know, they say they can still make it.
Mr. Horsfall, please.
So I mean, I agree with Patrick. If you look kind of what the Dane County facility has, matching that and coming in that direction,
might blend a little bit better than, I agree with these guys there, it's, you know, you look at the office building, it looks totally different than what you're trying to do with the residential, sure. But you look at the Dane County stuff, that looks more kind of fitting in with what you're trying to do too. So yeah, I take another shot at it and see.
Other comments? I agree with the comments that have been made so far, and you indicated you'll be coming back soon, so we would encourage you to work with the city staff.
That'd be great.
Thank you very much. Any other questions or comments? Mr. Lytle, please.
Just making sure that the parking count that you gave will be parking that's shared between the daycare, a potential future building to the west, as well as the fitness studio. We're not doubling the parking that's required just for this one facility.
Mr. Sayre?
No, the parking number that I gave was based upon everything that's east of this dashed line on the screen. So anything that'd be built with this facility, but it would be shared with the daycare, it would be shared with the fitness studio to the south, and most likely it'd be shared with the future building to the west. So no, we aren't. We're trying to be creative enough in there that we have a lot of parking out here. Let's not overbuild it. I think there will be some parking demands once that fitness studio is built, so I think it's smart to at least have this as an overflow, especially in that kind of evening crunch with the restaurant and the fitness and daycare. So I think there will be times when this lot is full or close to full, but there will be probably the majority of times it will be half empty. But we're not double dipping on the count by any means.
Yeah, I know that excessive parking had been a concern from what we've heard, and since it's close enough to Farm and Fleet that it might be a sore point for others. I just wanted to make sure we weren't going over the top in terms of parking.
Yeah, and I think when you look at that fitness studio with the space they have planned and potentially if they can draw that many people with the cycling and the yoga, it could be busy out here at certain times.
Yeah, I think part of their classes are kind of the peak time, so when they start about the same as like the daycare, as mentioned, the restaurants, there's gonna be a little peak surge there, so I wanna make sure we didn't cause a problem for anybody, you know, at that point. And I think too, if you got that future building, if there's not a parking problem, to be quite honest, we're not gonna build the rest of that parking there, we've already got it there, so.
Mr. Linder, please.
Yeah, I had one more question I forgot. So Mr. Sayre had mentioned about putting a little sidewalk, I guess that'd be east-west along Kimball Lane, is that correct?
Keenan Court, it'd be just south of the stormwater pond,
yep.
In this area.
Would you need one to go on each side of that section towards the parking lots up there, towards the parking lots? So that if somebody is parking for the studio and walking through, they have a little sidewalk to go on instead of walking through the entry and exit ways?
You're looking kind of
yep.
Up through this way?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if you can see that in the screen. Is it up there?
No.
Maybe on both sides
of
that. So
what Alderperson Linder is suggesting is putting trying to find a pedestrian connection on this side of the pond and also potentially on the east side.
Yeah.
I assume that's a retaining wall?
Yeah, it's probably a little bit of grade change there because we're doing that retention pond in through there. Because if I put that one, I'll say, in the west side or to the left of the screen, I probably wouldn't put the one then kind of right next to the daycare. So we've got that one coming down across from the daycare already. So I'd probably put that one in with the one on the daycare because I think that probably serves kind of both sides of the lot then.
Sure, that seems reasonable.
Okay.
Thank you. I'm not seeing any more questions. We look forward to seeing you again soon.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jerry. We are now on agenda item number 8. Which is discussion and possible action. If we were to take action, this would be a recommended action to the Common Council. It is a preliminary plat for Hometown Grove to create 32 single-family parcels and 20 zero-lot-line parcels located at 845 Kimball Lane. Mr. Sayre, if you'd provide the background, please.
Thank you. So this property is located immediately south of Glacier Edge Elementary School. The property is highlighted in yellow on the screen. The school is here for reference purposes. Gray's Tide House is right there, and there's two apartment buildings that's owned by the applicant as well. There's a long history with this parcel. I think some of you are familiar with it, but I'll try to briefly just go through that. In November of 2005, the city did approve a general development plan for this project. which authorized the construction of two apartment buildings and 94 townhouse units. The two apartment buildings have been constructed on the parcel to the east, and then we've had 16 townhouse units constructed in three different buildings. Obviously, after 2005, we had the Great Recession. So in 2009, 2010, a developer approached the city with amendments to the PUD due to a weak market for townhouses. The 2009 amendment requested a reduction in the number of townhouses and an increase in the number of apartment units. This amendment was not approved by the council in 2009, 2010. In 2010, a developer came forward proposing to eliminate all the unbuilt townhouses from the development and replace them with a single-family, duplex, and triplex buildings. The Planning Commission had concerns with the 2010 project, including the small lot sizes and narrow roads. The developer chose not to move forward with this project. In 2014, and here's the 2014 project, a developer proposed 35 single-family lots, 20 zero-lot line lots, and smaller streets. The 2014 plat and PUD was approved by the city in 2014. The developer chose not to move forward with this project at that time. So the 2014 project, just for memory's sake, and I think most of you were here for this, but the applicant proposed 35 single-family lots, which are yellow on the screen. The orangish area that was planned for the zero-lot line townhouses, as part of that project, they would pick up one of the existing townhouses and move it over to lots 48 to the 51. This project also had smaller roads than were typically allowed in residential developments. It had private alleyways and also a private park. The 2016 application, which is on your screen right now, the applicant is proposing to create 32 single-family lots and 20 zero-lot line lots. The zero-lot line concept is very, very consistent with what was approved in 2014. Once again, the existing townhouse, the existing four-unit townhouse would be picked up, moved over to lots 37 to 40, basically placed on that property. The applicant would have the ability to potentially construct an additional four-unit townhouse on 33 to 36. This project would be, like I said, 32 single-family lots. The road itself would be a typical city street. It would be 66 feet of right-of-way. That would include 36 feet face-to-face for the road itself from curb to curb. That's your standard city street that is found on most residential developments. If the project moves forward, the applicant would need to rezone the property to remove the PUD for the single family portion of the development. The proposed 20 zero lot lines is similar to the 2014 project, and the PUD for that would remain in place. The developer has already started the process to explore relocating the four-unit townhouse. The townhouse is in the way of the future roadway, so that's the first thing that would have to happen. I think tentatively the applicant is considering moving that here in the early summer. The lots itself that are being planned in this development would be zoned CR, which is a community residential zoning district. That district requires a minimum lot size of 6,000 square feet. The lots in this development range in size from 6,000 square feet to approximately 14,000 square feet. The CR district also requires a minimum lot width of 50 feet. The plat that is before you tonight does conform to the zoning requirements of the CR district. Staff does recommend the applicant review the dimensions of lots 14 and 15, which are in this corner here. I think potentially the shared lot line between the two could be pulled further to the east to create a larger buildable area for this development. For comparison purposes, this development is actually very similar to the first addition to the Badger Prairie neighborhood. The Badger Prairie neighborhood is located between Llano Street and Cross Country Road along North Edge Trail. From a lot size standpoint, from a square footage standpoint, a lot width standpoint, just from a dimensional standpoint, it has a lot of similarities to that project. So I think if the Planning Commission or Council is looking at a comparable project, this is probably the best example that we currently have in the city. The roads itself, as I stated previously, would be public roadways with 66 feet of right-of-way, 36 feet face-to-face for pavement. They would also have city sidewalks on both sides. So once again, it'd be your typical city street with the typical terrace area. One item that was discussed in 2014 by the Planning Commission and the Council was a fence or type of screening to screen the roadway from the adjacent condominium owners. Staff recommends that condition remain in place. Most likely that would involve either a fence or landscaping of some type. Staff would recommend landscaping just from a maintenance standpoint, and long-term, the landscaping would look better. As a condition of approval, staff does recommend that we have a condition in place that would require the landscaping or fence to be installed by the developer, but future maintenance of that would be the responsibility of the condominium association. In general, staff is supportive of developing this property as a typical single city subdivision. This is a very challenging parcel, obviously. It's been here multiple times. It's tough to try to fit anything into the site just because of how it's been configured and the challenges of what's there right now. I think, as everyone knows as well, the city is very quickly running out of vacant single-family parcels in the city, and this would help with our current limited supply that we have in place right now. So staff does recommend the Plan Commission recommend to the Common Council approval of the preliminary plat for the Hometown Grove development with the following condition: that one, the developer shall construct a privacy fence or landscaping on the condominium property to screen the condominium units from Schubert Street. The fence materials, size, location, and height or landscaping material shall be approved by the Director of Planning and Development. Once the fence is constructed or landscaping installed, maintenance of the fence shall be the responsibility of the condominium owners. The fence or landscaping shall be constructed or installed prior to the issuance of building permits for the single family houses. And with that, I know the applicant is here tonight. We'd be happy to answer any questions, or I'd be happy to answer any questions you have too.
Thank you, Mr. Sarah. Questions or comments from Planning Commission members? Mr. Linder, please.
Thank you, Mayor. So Mr. Sayer, the drawing you have up on at the bottom, where Schubert is at the bottom of the screen, does that have enough room to have any sort of screening between those buildings and that road? Looks really tight on that picture.
Mr. Sayer?
No, there is not. So the applicant would need to install the landscaping on the condominium association's property. That was kind of what was discussed in 2014. I did speak with I don't know if he's the president of the association now, but he used to be the president, but I did speak with the past or current president of the association about a month ago, and I know they were going to talk about this at their future upcoming annual meeting, which I think was being held this week at some point. I haven't heard back from him yet, but I think in the past agreement it would have been on the condominium property just because there is no space there. I think if you put it on the road, then it's going to be responsibility of either the city or one of the homeowners that is buying a lot there. I think it'd be smarter to put it on the condo lots because they want it, and they can ensure that it actually stays in place and is maintained properly.
So that'd be like sort of agreement with the developer and the condo owners then?
Yes, and yeah. He's open to continue that. He agreed to that back in 2014. He'll agree to that now.
Okay. Thank you. Go ahead, Mr. Linder.
Yeah, my overall thoughts on this are I believe this is a big improvement from the original design. Normal streets I think are a good idea. I like that the fact that there's no more of those alleys in there. That was one of my least favorite parts of the project. A little bit fewer units, so there's a little more space in here. Overall, I think this is improvement, and I was glad to see it tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Linder. And I would agree with your comments as well. I like it much better, and the fact that it's the streets will be built to city standards is very attractive to me as well, and not having any private streets. Other questions or comments, feedback? Mr. Arswell, please.
From a stormwater point of view, where's the water going to go? And is there a stormwater pond that's associated with this?
Mr. Mompass?
I believe this was all approved as a regional basin, if I'm correct, to the north. Adam?
Correct. The pond I think that it does get directed to is the pond between the apartment buildings and the Vincenzo Plaza kind of gas station area. There is a large pond, I believe, that it all gets directed to.
Go ahead, Mr. Horswell.
Yeah, second question is, normally when they do development like this, there's park money. Is it going to be fees in lieu of a park?
Mr. Sayer?
Yes, it'd be a fee in lieu of. So as part of this, we would need a developer's agreement for the construction of the public roadways. As part of that, we would spell out exactly what the fee is, but it would be based upon what is in the city ordinance.
And
a
third
Go
ahead, final question. Is the developer here?
Yes.
So
yes.
Lot 32, did you put a house on there? And that
Ron or Chuck, you, perhaps okay. You want to come up, please? Again, the same thing, we would ask that you identify yourself for the benefit of those watching at home.
Certainly. I'm Chuck Buell. I'm the project manager for Apex Property Management, and this is more than the first time that we've submitted this plan, but I think in the long run, we feel the same way, that it's after we had time to look at it, wasn't it? We had intended, obviously, to move ahead in the last approval, but circumstances and situations, again, didn't allow us to do that. But after taking a look at it, we feel like we backed off some, and after talking to Mr. Sayre about your past approvals on the private roads, we chose to have D'Onofrio redesign. If you can look at it, we see that some of those interior lots are much bigger, and that was to kind of eliminate the green space that we were looking at previous. Lot 32 is a buildable lot. I've gone on, and again, the intent of this development is still starter, you know, homes. So it can be a smaller home. All of the homes will be have to be designed within the building envelope that's shown on the plan. But I've gone on, I think it's, it's like 15,000 different designs on computer that you can pull up, and you can put in all the different dimensions that you need. And I think I ended up with probably 15 or 16 different choices for that exact lot. And so I'm confident that we can build on that lot, as all the rest of the lots.
Great, thank you.
Other questions or comments? Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, Mr. Buell, for coming back again with what I think is also a better plan than what the city had approved a couple of years ago. I echo the comments about getting rid of the private alleyways and having the 66-foot wide roads, and I think that the decision to do that, and even though you end up with three fewer lots, it just, I think, flows better. The lots, some of them are a little bit bigger. I'm not a huge fan of the CR zoning classification as a general matter, but given where this is located, you know, adjacent to a school, adjacent to townhomes, adjacent to, you know, large apartment complexes, if there's an appropriate place to zone, you know, very small lots in the city of Verona, I think this is an appropriate place for it. So I'm prepared to support.
Thank you.
What you brought forward.
Thank you.
Mr. Buell, just one other question. I know we've talked about this in the past, and I'm assuming, but I don't want to make that assumption. This development would be open to any builder to build. It's not a close to one or two or three builders.
That is correct. In fact, that was part of why we've held off, is because we did have several opportunities to involve or actually sell a piece of property, but the owners of the property chose to continue to do what we promised, and that was to be able to have them open to builders. Most likely we would choose a couple, two or three builders initially, to have a couple, but our intention is really for our construction company in-house to be in a position to build several of them. I don't think it's reasonable to think we're going to build 32 of them, but we'd like to have some. So yes, we're going to continue that.
Thank you. Other questions, comments, potential motions? If we were to take action, again, this would be a recommendation to the Common Council. Mr. Lytle, please.
Question for Adam quick. Knowing the space and crowding issues at Glacier Edge, and I think they've tried to find some sort of stopgap for that, do you have any idea? I mean, there's been plans similar to this on the horizon for this property for quite a while. Do you have any specific recollection whether the school district was expecting, was building this as however many?
Mr. Sarah?
52 lots.
Yeah, so 32 lots. I know when this did come in, I did share it with the superintendent and the assistant superintendent. And I, you know, they've known since 2014 that we've been looking at something in here. It was included in the enrollment projections that were presented on Monday night. So Mark Roffers, the consultant they used, was fully aware that this was coming forward and most likely would potentially have kids living here potentially, you know, late this year, early 2017. So I don't know how exactly that impacts the school district from the class size standpoint, but we've been pretty transparent with the district that this is a project that's moving forward. And yeah, all the kids here are going to be going across the street, so it does have a direct and significant impact on the school. But it's been out there now for 2 years, so I don't think it wasn't a surprise by any means. It was, I think they've been waiting for it. It's just, it was a matter of, okay, now here it is.
Yeah, I was assuming it wasn't a surprise. I just wanted to verify and have it on the record. Thanks.
Good question. Mr. Linder, please.
Yeah, one final. So Mr. Sayer brought up, I think it's lot 15 is a little, maybe moving the line more towards 14 on the bottom right of this. Is that something you guys are amenable to? Do we need to put that in here?
Well, we did check that a lot. And again, I think it's approximately at the building location on the setback. I've got about 60 feet of frontage, you know, into the building. And easily I can get at least 40 feet depth in there without a problem. So I would rather keep it the way it is. 14 will be just as interesting of a lot because it's the long and narrow. I'd really like to leave the lots where they're at. I know that Ryan Kloss and D'Onofrio had done a fairly significant study to actually recommend where the lot lines were. And I'm comfortable with that, being able to build on it. I think you'd mentioned lot 32 is probably a little more of a challenge than that lot is. Okay. But again, I've gone on, looked at many different smaller house designs, and there's really no problem being able to fit a decent house on there. I think this presentation is going to offer larger homes than what we did in the previous presentation. And in fact, all of them will be front loaded, no alleys. We will not be having a homeowners association because we don't need to. There won't be parks or alleys to have to maintain. So that's kind of taken out of the mix here. So it should really fall in very similar to your CR designs. My son lives up on Fairview. I built him a home there about 6-7 years ago, and that was one of the Heinrichs lots, and that was a CR design, I believe, and they love it. I mean, the home fit in well. That neighborhood is really a fun neighborhood, and I'm looking forward to seeing this neighborhood being very similar to that.
Thank you. Other questions, comments? Mr. Sayre, did you have something to add, please?
Yeah, just regarding that lot line, it was more just a general comment to kind of throw it out there. It wasn't a strong recommendation or recommend as a condition, mostly just of having the developer take a look at that to make sure that it's being designed properly now. So, I mean, I didn't intend it as a condition, mostly okay, just to make sure we had the review of it and they would take a look at it.
Other comments, questions, potential motions? Mr. Horsfall, please.
This time I'd like to recommend that the Common Council approve the preliminary plat for the Hometown Grove development with the following conditions outlined in the report.
Thank you. We do have a motion. Is there a second? Seconded by Mr. Heinzen. Questions or comments on the motion? Questions or comments? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. That motion carries, and likewise, that will be on the council agenda for Monday evening. Thank you. We are now on agenda item number 9, which is no action this evening. This is discussion regarding concept review of the proposed Kettle Creek North subdivision to create 152 single-family lots and 144 multifamily units. Mr. Sayre, if you would provide the background, please.
Thank you. So for location purposes, the parcels highlighted in yellow are the proposed location of this conceptual review tonight. It is just located north of Country View Elementary School. The property is owned by H&H Properties, which also Tony Heindrichs owns it. That's his company. The request tonight is just conceptual only. The applicant requested that to kind of receive feedback from both the Plan Commission and Common Council prior to moving forward with the platting process and prior to moving forward with the engineering of the site as well. As the mayor explained, the applicant is looking at approximately 152 single-family lots and approximately 144 apartment units. The development would include a mixture of lots that would be zoned neighborhood residential and also community residential. For point of just note on how this could be developed, approximately one-third of the property on the south half of it could potentially be developed today. That portion of the property does drain to the south. The northern two-thirds of this property from a line just by the water tower to the north, that actually drains into the future north neighborhood, which has a large regional basin located in this area. So until that north neighborhood develops, I think the development on the northern half of this would be challenging. This property was annexed to the city in 2000. My report said 2009, but it was actually annexed in the year 2000. As part of that annexation, there was a concept plan that was included with that. That concept was exclusively single family. Ultimately, that 2000, the concept from the year 2000 did not move forward. This property was included in our north neighborhood planning area as we looked at all the land uses in this area. And the north neighborhood plan was approved in February of 2015 by the council. As part of that, that plan did identify this property as mostly as future suburban residential. So the applicant has requested a conceptual review tonight and also before the Common Council next Monday. If the project does move forward, it would require a plat approval, rezoning, a developer's agreement, and an amendment to the city's comprehensive plan. Here's the conceptual layout that was provided by the applicant. The majority of the site, which is in yellow, would be zoned for neighborhood residential. Approximately 17 lots would be zoned for community residential. Staff has no concerns with this mixture of single family zoning. It's consistent with other developments that we have in the city. As part of this, the applicant is proposing a parcel in the middle that is approximately 5.8 acres that would be zoned multifamily for apartments. The applicant has indicated this project would be similar in character to the Sienna Ridge projects that are located on North Main Street and would contain approximately 144 apartments. From a connectivity standpoint and looking at the road and pedestrian connections, staff has really no concerns with how this development would be connected. They are providing the connections that were recommended in the North Neighborhood Plan, including the extension of Esker Drive, extension of Tamarack Way, extension of Hemlock Drive, and also the extension of Zing Drive. All those extensions were recommended within that North Neighborhood Plan to provide just better connectivity for this development, the development to the north, and also the existing development to the south. As part of this, the applicant is also proposing a recreation trail that would extend from Country View up into the future north neighborhood. Staff has no concerns with that connection. The only comment that staff would make on that would be we'd recommend that there be a leg of that trail stubbed to the east over to the proposed park just to provide a connection into that actual park space. Speaking of parks, the applicant is proposing two parks in the conceptual plan. The westernmost park with the trail running through it contains some existing woods and kettles. The eastern park, which is located right there, would potentially have space for an active ball field. Staff has no concerns with the parkland locations at this time. The park board did provide an initial review of the concept and was supportive of the park on the east side of Hemlock. The North Neighborhood Plan did identify a future park location, actually just north of the softball fields in this location. Staff does feel that the proposed park in this spot here is consistent with our North Neighborhood Plan. The plan itself, the North Neighborhood Plan, is not intended to be a regulating plan where you have to locate things precisely as they are on that plan. It's supposed to make sure it's guiding towards the intent and the goal of that plan. So staff does believe that park in this location is appropriate. As I stated previously, the applicant is proposing both single-family and multifamily uses within the concept. The North Neighborhood Plan, which is the kind of the excerpt, that plan is on the screen here. The Heinrich property is this, the area that's colored to the south of here, was planned as both wooded residential and suburban residential. The lighter brown color in this location was the wooded residential. The yellow color is the suburban residential. The wooded residential was planned to create some larger lots of approximately 12 to 15,000 square feet, with the intent that some of that wooded area could be protected and you wouldn't lose all the trees as development happens. The suburban residential was planned to have lot sizes from 6,000 to 10,000 square feet. In general, the intent of the single family in the concept is consistent with the North Neighborhood Plan. The multifamily component of this project obviously is not consistent with what the plan has, and if the project does move forward, the applicant would have to request an amendment to the North Neighborhood Plan to accommodate the multifamily use. I think as everyone knows, the city does have a residential phasing policy that's been effective since October 1st of 2012. What this policy does, it limits the approvals of multifamily development in the city to a target range of 25 to 50 new multifamily units each year. Specifically, the policy states, for newly proposed residential subdivisions that include a mix of single-family, duplex, and multifamily parcels, the city establishes a target ratio to include at least 75% single-family and duplex units and no more than 25% multifamily units. The city intends to utilize the zoning and planning authority to achieve this target ratio. However, the city may approve projects that deviate from the target ratio based upon the characteristics and locations of individual projects. There also are exemptions provided to that policy, which includes senior housing, downtown multifamily, and also redevelopment property, redevelopment. The applicant has not identified a specific type of multifamily housing in this location. And potentially, if it was senior housing or something of that nature, it could be exempted from the city's current policy. The multifamily would require a planned unit development from the city to grant some exemptions. And just for note, the city currently has zero multifamily units allocated to 2016 and beyond. Some comments from staff, real briefly, is that our North Neighborhood Plan was adopted in February 2015. When we were creating that, I know conversations that we've had here in the Plan Commission and also with the council, a lot of attention and detail was provided, was paid to looking at where multifamily was being located within that plan. And I think the overall context of the plan is on the screen that was kind of submitted by the applicant here. So we have the applicant's project here, and then this generally follows what was adopted by the Plan Commission and Council. But we did take a lot of care into locating multifamily that we felt would be a transition between the commercial areas and also a transition from the commercial to the single family. So the multifamily was placed in locations where it would then transition into single family from the commercial, from busy roadways. We tried to push the multifamily towards County Highway M, County Highway PD as well to reduce trips. In the past, before the adoption of that plan, the city did have a general policy that encouraged the mixture of multifamily into developments. So for example, with the Scenic Ridge development, there is multifamily that we've approved and that was planned in there with the intent of trying to mix multifamily and single family together. I think based upon the feedback that I know I've received from the Plan Commission and Council and just from being in this room when those projects have come forward, I don't know if that policy had the intent that we initially had planned on, just based upon the reaction that we've had from people living in those developments and then having these projects proposed next to them. So part of the reason we kind of deviated from that as part of the North Neighborhood was based upon the reaction of the Scenic Ridge project, based upon the reaction from the Sienna Ridge project as well. So we've kind of now shifted away from mixing multifamily in now to single family projects. And this was actually one of the discussion points from 2000 when this concept came forward. That was a point that was raised by staff at that time, even saying, listen, in 2000 the project was exclusively single family. Should we be recommending a mixture of multifamily at that time? And the impression I was left with after reading that staff report was probably not in this location. We don't, we have our might be planned to the north as well. But that was even discussed back in 2000. I will say from a staff level perspective, at this time, staff cannot support the inclusion of multifamily into this development. The inclusion of it right now, it's not consistent with what was adopted as part of the North neighborhood. I think if the city were to approve multifamily in this location, I think the pressure I think we're already gonna face in that North neighborhood, which is already there, is gonna be to probably look at more than what we initially had talked about. I think it's going to happen. It's not a question of if, it's just when. But I think if it's approved in this location, I think there is a strong possibility. I'm not sure how we'd be in much of a position to say no to more of this in the future. So I do have concerns with kind of opening up that door of future requests that I'm pretty confident will be coming at some point. But I guess with that being said, staff does recommend the Planning Commission review the submitted materials and provide feedback to the applicant. I know the applicant is here tonight. I'm sure he'd be happy to answer any questions. I'm not sure if he wants to add anything else, I guess, before the Planning Commission discusses it. But there would be no action tonight, though. There's no motion on this tonight. But it will go to the council on Monday night for the same kind of feeling of feedback, general feelings, ideas, and but yeah, so that's the end of my report. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Serra, for the background on that. Questions, comments, feedback from Planning Commission members? Mr. Linder, please.
Sure, I'll get it started here. I was glad to see there was a project proposed. I was kind of wondering when this would come forward at some point. My thoughts are, I like the wooded area. Looks to be a lot of CR. I guess I'm not as big a fan of that either. I think Mr. Manley mentioned earlier, I'm not a big fan of that. But the multifamily I've been on this commission long enough to know that having an next to the residential like that just causes problems. We, did the best we could with some stuff that had been approved before in the past. But now we have a chance to, I think, prevent the problem to begin with. So I'm not a fan of the multifamily at all, to be honest. The couple parks are good. I'm sure there's a lot of options you can do with the parks. I like the trail. But I'm not a big fan of all the CR lots, and I'm the multifamily is what gets me the most, which I like the least.
Thank you, Mr. Linder. Other comments, feedback? Others? Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yeah, I want to begin by thanking Mr. Heinrichs for bringing forward a residential development. As Adam had mentioned before, we're very quickly running out of inventory in our city for housing, and I think there continues to be pretty significant demand in our city for housing, particularly single family housing. I know a number of families who are trying to get into Verona, and they just can't. So this is great, and I'm glad to see a proposal moving forward that will bring additional single family to our city. I agree from a planning standpoint that the multifamily is just not something that I'm comfortable with. I don't think it is in keeping with the existing neighborhood in that area. And Mr. Sayer mentioned, some of the conflicts and problems that we've bumped into over the years. Even when people were, should have had notice ahead of time that they were building in an area where there was, multifamily planned, that didn't do anything to diminish the anger, frankly, that putting large apartment complexes in residential, single-family residential neighborhoods is generated. So that piece of it for me is just, I think when we looked at the amendment to our comprehensive plan for the North neighborhood, I think we as a city made a very specific policy decision that we wanted to locate multifamily in the north neighborhood in a very specific area, and that's in the northeast sort of area where it would serve as a buffer between the commercial development that we expect to occur along Highway PD and Highway M and other areas that will develop as single family further south and closer to Kettle Creek. I also agree, and I've said it before, I'm just not really even a fan of the CR zoning classification. I'd love to see those CR lots taken out and be replaced with larger lots. I think that that's, again, more consistent with and in keeping with what we see on Tamarack Way and Esker Drive and Lone Pine and Dunhill and Zing, the existing neighborhood. I think it would be much more complementary to the existing Kettle Creek neighborhood to have those larger lots. And in fact, I think that's probably more consistent with where the real estate market is anyway. I've got a decent number of my old neighbors in the Kettle Creek subdivision, or I should say my former neighbors. Maybe some of them are getting old. But some of my former neighbors who built, maybe their starter home in the first phases of Kettle Creek and would like to build something bigger as their family has grown into the next area of Kettle Creek. In terms of the parks, green space is always nice. Looking at the existing green space that's adjacent to Country View Elementary, both with the softball fields and the practice fields and the playground equipment there, I almost wonder if you even need two parks. If you wanted to get some additional larger single-family lots out of some of that green space, that would be acceptable to me. So that's just, I guess, general feedback that I have. I've got a question as it relates to the transportation infrastructure here. And I don't know if it's a question for the developer or for staff or for the city engineer, but basically if the lower third of this development drains south and you could only build a very limited number of single family homes as contemplated in the plan, that many single family homes probably, I'm guessing, doesn't put such a tremendous strain on traffic relative to the existing neighborhoods that it would be cause for concern for the city. But if we were gonna get much further north into the area that drains into the north neighborhood, it seems to me that, we could be adding quite a bit of sort of self-contained traffic into a small area that would get necessarily pushed onto Zing, Hemlock, and Tamarack, unless we have an east-west connection to Highway M, which it shows as an arrow, which I'm taking to mean that would be a future connection. But I wonder at what point, if this develops, would people in that neighborhood have a reasonable expectation that connection will happen and be a sort of an outlet valve for traffic coming into that neighborhood, into the newer part of the development.
Mr. Serrell, director to you first.
Sure, I can take a shot at this. So I think the question, and I'll just pull it up on the screen, I'm not sure if it's there. So I think Mr. Manley's question is, when the two-thirds of this kind of site develops, if, how, and when would there be a road connection going into the north neighborhood or going east in some fashion in some location to get out to County Highway M? And I think there's a couple challenges of that, but I think there's probably a solution. The challenge obviously is it's not controlled by this developer. That land is owned by, well, this parcel here is owned by Brett Backus, and this 200 acres here is owned by Dennis Midtune. Mr. Midtune has his property actually on the market right now and is actively trying to sell that property. I think in reality is when this northern two-thirds develops, it needs to have that pond there. It can't develop without that pond. I mean, there's no stormwater shown on this site plan or on this concept. I'm guessing when this pond is developed, I would, and Mr. Monpass can correct me if I'm wrong, but I would suspect when this is developed, you're probably going to see development happen at the same time on the east side here, and you're probably going to see some development off the back here as well. There's a significant cost with that facility that they're going to need to justify basically building that and going through that. They're going to need a decent chunk of development. So what I would suspect it would happen is you potentially would have this connection coming through here in that way. I think that's the one that when Mr. Midtune develops or sells and someone else develops it, that's the most logical one that could happen when his property goes. Obviously, when Mr. Backus develops his, that will happen as well, too, to connect to Heineken. But just of how this whole area is going to function from a closed basin standpoint, I'd be very surprised if someone's is going to build this pond up here, and with the cost of how much that's going to cost and the infrastructure required with that, that the road isn't being pushed out to this location. It's difficult to have a certainty in place, but the fact that the northern two-thirds of Mr. Heinrich's property is dependent upon this stormwater pond, I think it gives us some potential leverage as we look at projects in this area. I think that the southern one-third of the site itself, I think obviously, you know, in the short term, the existing infrastructure can accommodate that, but I think we will probably have the ability as this develops in this northern part and also this area develops too. I think we'll have that ability to ensure that connection is in place. I don't think there's any way we could potentially, you know, it'd be challenging to deny a project or require a developer to put a road through someone else's property. I think that'd be very challenging, and there'd be, I just don't know how we could potentially do that, but I think it's a fair conversation. If this property is draining into that development to the north, I think there's a chance we could tie these together and make sure that we could potentially do that.
Go ahead, Mr. Manley.
So what I'm hearing is that at such time as we would see that additional development in the northern half of this parcel, there will be other development and improvements likely happening consecutive to that, that you could address those traffic access issues at that time.
I feel pretty good we can do that, just because the northern two-thirds of this is so dependent upon that pond. I think there's going to be ample opportunity from the Plan Commission and Council to ensure that would happen.
Thank you.
Other feedback, questions, comments? Mr. Horsfall, please.
Yeah, I agree with our fellow commissioner's opinion about the multifamily on the north side. And I like that in the northern neighborhood plan, we were talking about on the northwest side of the school that would be residential, larger lots, and trying to save as many trees as we can on that area. That's a real big point from my point of view. And I mean, I'd like to see that in this plan coming up. The other thing is, you know, I know that the North Neighborhood Plan talks about Zing Drive being a kind of a collector, but it just, you know, it doesn't really make sense from, I guess, looking at it, because all it does is just push you into the neighborhood, and it doesn't give you a quick access out like Hemlock and Tamarack. So I know that was in the original plan, but it somewhat doesn't make any sense to me, because it, you know, if you go southbound on Zing, you're just going into the neighborhood, and to get out of the neighborhood, you have to go over to Hemlock or go through, you know, Gateway. So that's always been an issue for me, I guess. That's just a comment. Otherwise, you know, like you said, we need housing stock, and this is an area that was going to be developed probably in, when I was on the commission in 2000, we were going to be doing this in 2006, you know, so here it is 2016 and we're taking another shot at it. So those are just my comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Horsfall. Other comments? Mr. Lytle, please.
So there's probably a really simple answer to this question, but it appears that on the north side of the developer's property lies some sort of existing quarter section, 1/16th section, that's already there. But yet we're not planning a road on a what seems like an obvious place to put a road. We have to shift it south again because it's a matter of the developer not having control of the other half of where that road would be. It seems like the road, it's the main east-west road on the north end is one lot farther south than it should be.
Mr. Sayre?
I think part of the intent there is to line it up on with Eineken Drive on M. I think that's part of the intent there is to kind of get that alignment over here with Eineken because there is limited access on 2M. So I would suspect that's probably the intent of kind of that's how this was conceptually drawn up, was trying to make that a direct line of sight to get that through.
And so to the at the northwest edge of the developer's property, we have a T in what has been a straight direct route east-west. So the North Neighborhood Plan has no specifics regarding going on west of there. There's an existing sort of rural subdivision. We have no idea, no indication where that next road to the west would be located.
Mr. Sayre?
I think what you're referencing is this town subdivision. So that is currently in the town of Verona. It is a larger lot subdivision. I think the lots are a few acres in size. So no, that plan never contemplated that parcel. With our current draft boundary agreement with the town, that is land that currently would potentially stay in the town as part of that boundary agreement as well. So no, the neighborhood plan never contemplated that. And kind of looking back at the concept here, this was actually from the plan itself. We did have that larger east-west kind of coming through just south of the intersection of PD and M. So that was an east-west route that we did plan that would ultimately connect to Nine Mound Road in the future. So that is what we're basing our Nine Mound Road plan, road design plans on. There also was a connection from Eineken. It looks like we're kind of wrapping up towards that direction. I think the question would be is, should that road be teed or should it naturally kind of almost parallel that larger east-west collector to the north? And it's up to the Planning Commission ultimately.
I mean, I'm fine either way. The developer obviously has to weigh the pros and cons with that. But you know, you see lot 286 in the north east corner of the development sitting there as an island, and not knowing what's going to happen to the north and east of that, how do you promote consistency? And similarly, that whole row of lots on the north edge, how do we connect that up with what happens next? I realize there's a lot of unknowns at this point, but it seems like that puts those lots at a risk of not being harmonized with what happens going on versus anticipating some sort of slight jog to the north of Eineken and keeping that road staying on the very north edge of the development. Then just to respond with my perspective, I did support the idea of having a small multifamily in each residential subdivision. I'm still supportive of keeping multifamily at a scale such that there's not a huge swath of apartment buildings in any one location in our city. And I think we did a fairly good job of planning for that in the way the multifamily is broken up on the north and east edge of the North Neighborhood Plan. So I I would agree that on the north edge of the softball fields maybe is not the best place for multifamily. I would respectfully disagree with the commissioners on the other side of the room in terms of community residential. I think what makes Verona attractive and what makes it a strong community is there's a variety of housing options. I live in a subdivision, Fairview, that has a significant grouping of community residential. I believe it's made the subdivision more vibrant. There's young families that move in there. You see lots of kids, lots of people out walking. I would encourage us to retain some portion of community residential along with the regular neighborhood residential in any of these developments. If we want to reduce the scale or spread them out a little more, I would be supportive of that, but I think maintaining a mix, including community residential, is a better option for the city and makes us a better destination and a place where families can move and grow into larger lots when they want to move that direction. So that's my feedback.
Thank you, Mr. Lytle. Additional questions, comments? Mr. Heinzen, please.
Sure, thank you. I'm going to actually echo Mr. Lytle's comments with respect to housing and multifamily housing. I have sort of consistently been less troubled by apartment buildings if they are sized correctly near residential and multifamily, other multifamily homes. And so I'm not so sure about the particular location. I do like the green space, and I think that even, you know, giving some consideration to swapping what is currently the proposed park to the east with multifamily could make some sense. I think there's some benefit to having green space, even if it's not one single, or even if it's a number of different parks to just continue through a neighborhood. And it would, you know, make bike path particularly nice as well. One concern I think I have, though, is Mr. Heinrichs could speak to this, but we have so little forested space in the city, and as somebody who has looked for a long time finding lots that have some amount of trees on them, it strikes me that maybe with as many lots set forth in this area that a lot of those woods would be lost, and maybe that's not the case, but that would be my one concern. Because it strikes me that it's a very valuable aspect to the city to have an area that is, you know, has really well-grown trees.
Just I'll give my 2 cents worth. I also want to thank Mr. Heinrichs for coming forward with a plan. We certainly need additional residential lots, specifically single family lots in the city. I had the opportunity a couple months ago to sit down and talk to Tony, and he knows my personal opinion on this, and I just do not believe and cannot support multifamily in this area, especially because of the location of where it is. It's a very desirable area, I believe, because of the vicinity to the elementary school, the softball fields and everything else. I just don't think it's the best use for that property. It's not consistent with what we had agreed on as far as our plan for that area. We will be having some multifamily to the north in the next plan. We know that that's coming. I don't have an issue with the area for the proposed parks because I think that makes a lot of sense. Fits in well with the neighborhood, and it's consistent with what our plan was for parks. So my only issue here is the multifamily, and Mr. Heinrichs is aware of my position on that. But I do appreciate you coming forward and at least with the potential of opening up some additional single family lots in the city. Other questions or comments or anything, Mr. Heinrichs, that you would like to add? If you would, please.
I do thank you for your comments, and this is a concept plan. And what I was kind of excited about the plan, as Adam has even alluded to, most of us kind of have, is there's a lack of all sorts of housing in the community, you know, whether it's multifamily. Adam mentioned that there's nothing planned in 2016 or 2017, whether it's smaller lots, larger lots. And so I guess when we took a look at this, that was, we're like, how do we hit all the bases and how do we try and appease everybody on the boards and commissions and powers to be? Just maybe just a couple of quick thoughts on the multifamily. You know, we are certainly open for something reasonable. A word I heard here tonight was a sizable. We're just looking for feedback on that. I understand and respect what the neighborhood plan, you know, was adopted and approved. Just a couple of quick notes on that. Let's see. I get a little nervous talking in front of people. In Business Magazine in November, it talks about Epic and the migration that grows into Verona. They talked about back in 2002, 10 people living, and now there's 700 people living in the area. So I think some of the multifamily could. There's a need and demand, and in the marketplace now, the millennials like the flexibility of their lifestyle. There's more Epic people staying within the community. It's close to Epic, close to the schools. We could even look at potential some senior housing there. You know, there could potentially be a need and demand for that. I was at the Monday night, the Verona School, and they were talking about some large numbers and the growth and what type of growth, and they said, and I just quote, a sizable amount of growth that they are predicting and planning for in the next 15, 20 years. Was multifamily, and that's in the Verona School District. That's just not in the city of Verona. That includes Fitchburg and whatnot too. But they were talking about 50% of the population could come from multifamily. So there has been a seems to be a, kind of a demand for that, and but we're here to again get more feedback, and we're here to work with the city and obviously the planning commission, the board, and try and address concerns to the existing neighborhood.
Thank you. It looks like we have some questions. So Mr. Heinzen and then Mr. Linder, please.
I guess this is more of a comment than it is a question. And this goes much further than what we're talking about right now, but what Mr. Heinrichs noted is something that I don't know if we've talked about very much in the past, and that has to do with multifamily housing. And I just wonder whether or not with Epic in town, and I don't know what the numbers are here, but if we like the idea of professionals living in the city of Verona, there could be some benefit to having some very, very nice multifamily housing so that people who are working at Epic and do not have families but think the community is a good place to stay will already begin to put some roots into the town, so that when they do need to or do want to buy a home, start a family, that they will already have some, they'll have their roots here. And if we don't have really high quality multifamily housing, we lose a lot of people to the neighboring communities. I think that's just something that we need to give some thought to.
Thank you, Mr. Heinzen. Mr. Linder, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I don't know if this is for Mr. Heinrichs or for staff, but Mr. Lytle, I thought, brought up a good point as far as the road on the north. I mean, I know it's potentially lining up with Heineken, but it could, if it went across the lot line, so to speak, and then it jogged down to the right, you know, towards that green, brown, yellow area, I think that could be done. But I don't know how. Is that something that's feasible to build on a road and on the lot line, since you only own one half of it? Yeah, I don't know what that, if that's possible.
I don't know, Mr. Heinrichs, if you're prepared to respond to that this evening or not.
I mean, you look at the cross country on the bottom.
I didn't quite follow you, but I'm here for listening purposes.
Mr. Kloss understood what I was saying.
I did. Okay. Ron Kloss, D'Onofrio Kotke. When the city does the land planning, and I'll use the North neighborhood in this example, you start from an idealistic standpoint of, if it's all one big development, this is how we'd like to do it. Then as the developer, the first guy moves forward, and in this case that's Tony, he has to come in with a practical solution. And we look at Midtoon's land, it could be next year, or it could be 10 years before that development is to Tony's north boundary. We don't know. So if Tony wants to move forward, we have to find a solution that works for him. So yeah, in theory, you could build a road on the property line, but who pays for the other half?
Right.
Yeah.
That's what I'm asking.
Right.
How that works.
So it has occurred. We've done that in the past when both sides are ready to move forward or it's imminent. But in this case, we just don't know. So that's why, from a planning perspective, and that answers what you had brought up earlier too, Patrick, we said, okay, we better plan our entire property to make it work by itself. So that's what led us to this layout. But it is conceptual. This is why we're here, for the input.
Mr. Lytle, please.
What I see you giving up in terms of dedication for a road is the full width of that road through the property owned by Heinrichs. Why couldn't you give up the full width of that road on the north border of the property instead of having one row of... And you've maybe thought about that, and there's a very good reason behind it. It just seems to make the transition to the next phases more difficult when you have this approved with this row of sort of orphan lots there.
Well, economics is the first thing. If you build an expensive road and all the utilities under it, you like to utilize both sides. So if he builds it right on his north line, and again, it's 10 years before anything is there, and he may not ever be reimbursed for that other half of the road that he doesn't get to use, the frontage of it.
Can I jump in there?
Go ahead, Mr. Linder.
You're paying for the whole road now.
Well, we get to use both sides.
But you'll be using both. You'll be... I don't see what you're losing, I guess.
On Patrick's scenario, if that road were built right against our north property line, Tony would never get to use the north half of the road.
Correct, but you still get your potentially row of houses below it. You're still paying for the road the same. You're still using the same amount of resources, just shifting it inside the existing.
Well, but he would lose this whole row of lots on the north side of the road.
Correct, he would.
But they'd be potentially be on the south side of the road.
He'd only have half the road, so you'd have houses on the south side of the road, but the north side of the road,
yes.
He'd be building a road for a different developer, basically. That's what's going on, is that right now you double load the side of the road, so you, with the cost of that, you have development happening on both sides. And you're right, you're building the road regardless, but on the lot line itself, or just off it onto Tony's property, you've only got the one set of houses to offset the cost of that. And the second issue I think you have is that you're potentially building that road for a different developer, then you're probably looking at some type of recapture agreement or some type of other agreement with that developer trying to recapture the cost of it. So it is doable, but I agree with Mr. Klaus that it's challenging. We are looking at trying to split a lot line on Dennis Midtoon's property here and Jerry Andrus's property. And that, even that is challenging, but the advantage of that road is that one's going to be about 80 feet wide. It's a larger road that's going to have a part of a boulevard section down the middle. So we can build half of that quite easily, then drop it potentially down onto Dennis Midtoon's property to provide access. So we can easily build half of it. This is just going to be a typical 36 face-to-face road. I mean, I don't know how we could build half of it and have it actually meet city standards. I mean, it's going to be... By moving it to the lot line, I guess my comment is you're potentially putting an unfair burden on that developer. Now, I think it's a fair comment to how can you get that swung back up so you're not making that T intersection over here. I mean, if that's the root of the issue, how do we make that kind of a smooth road? I think there's ways you could potentially wrap that road to the north in this location and kind of hook it in from there. So you're not teeing it, then having to make a hard right, then probably a hard left again. I think there's ways you could design that without single loading the road, but it is challenging if you're going to single load the road. It does make it very, very difficult for developers. And also, like I said, you're giving a benefit to additional developer by he'd have to build the entire road, and does he get paid back for that? I don't know. It does complicate it. I think the simplest solution, if you don't like that tee, you just try to get the road wrapped up there to hook in at a different angle and eliminate the T.
One, perhaps what we can do is come back with a concept of how the next row could be done to the north.
Yeah.
This is not unusual, I'll say, when you get to a boundary line.
Mr. Linder?
Yeah, my concern wasn't the T so much as to how it merges into the future development. That's kind of where I was going.
Okay.
Kind of see your point, but in some ways I don't, because you're already paying for the road both sides anyway. But anyway, is it feasible at this stage to have an agreement with Mr. Midtoon that if any future development happens, you get reimbursed for a road if you put it on the line?
I don't know the answer to that.
Okay. I don't know. I guess something.
Answer to that. I think it would be pretty difficult.
Tony, can you use the microphone?
Yeah, use the microphone, please.
I'm sorry. It might be, I think it would be extremely challenging to try and accomplish that with Dennis, not because not trying to work something out with Dennis Midtoon, but he's putting his property out for sale. So how can he kind of commit that to some future developer down the road?
I guess for me, from my standpoint on the commission, if it's something that's possible, something to look at, that's my feedback. That's what I guess I'm going at.
We can do that.
Go ahead, Mr. Linder.
I did have another question, this one, or another comment before I forget, that this may be more for staff, but if this path gets in here, it would be nice potentially to intersect with the school. If that school doesn't, if it stays there to have it, or wherever that is, to hook up with that school, I think that would be good. And then
Mr. Linder, when you say that school, you mean to the school to the north?
Yes, future school.
Future school, yes. Okay.
And then the other thing I'm not sure if Mr. Manley was going this way or not, but you're talking about the connection to Zing Road. Is there concerns about having too much traffic on residential streets? I don't know, because if you potentially have a collector all the way from PD, all the way, people could be traveling all the way through these single family to get down to Mr. Heinrich's development from the north. I don't know if there's any concern with too much traffic on residential streets or not, once it's connected in the future north neighborhood.
Yeah, I guess my opinion on that is no. I think we have enough issues already in the city where we lack north-south connections, especially. I think there's ways on Zing and other roads as well that we could look at, you know, where stop signs are being placed, the slow traffic down. I think there's ways through design of the road. I mean, you know, even looking at the design before tonight, I mean, you could potentially look at curving the road a little bit and making sure it's not a straight shot. There's ways you can design roadways and put in stop signs to calm traffic. But I think you, from a planning perspective, I think you want those connections. mostly because if you don't have those connections, I think you're going to funnel a lot more traffic onto M. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's fine if you want to do that. But then if you're funneling that onto M, then you're going to have people coming about through the south side of the neighborhood to get back in here. I mean, the more you provide, the less opportunity one of these is going to become a very busy traffic route. And I think the way you deal with that is by stop signs and whatnot, and probably trying to direct people to the road that is going past the school. If there is a busier road in there, it's going to be that one because of the school, and it's going to be the fact that it will line up with the University Ridge Golf Course on the north. That will be the larger of the roads that are going there south.
Thank you.
I think if I could add to that, and having had the experience the last 8 years living in a subdivision that we were the second home to be built to now being fully built out, what I really notice is that, well, number one, our streets are all built to city standards, so they're built to handle the traffic for those subdivisions. But what happens as the area develops, as new streets are added, new entrances and exits to the subdivisions, traffic patterns change, and people find what is the most convenient, the easiest, and the fastest way for them to get in and out of subdivision. So, you know, recently in, again, the subdivision that I live in, the people were concerned about the added traffic of the apartments. Well, then the apartments start building, people's traffic patterns change, and you think you've got it all figured out where people are going to go, and then someone decides to close Locust Bridge for a couple months. And all the traffic goes through a new subdivision again. So my point is here that, 2 points, I guess. One is all of our streets are built to the city standards that they can handle the traffic that the subdivisions will provide. That's one point. And then the second point is traffic patterns will change because people will find the most convenient and fastest way to get in and out of their subdivisions. Mr. Manley, did you have your hand up?
I did. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I was just going to, I wanted to add one more piece of feedback for Tony and Ron, and before I do that, I'll just try and clarify for Mr. Linder what I meant when I was talking about the traffic. So we've got I think 135 units in the Kettle Creek and Kettle Woods development right now, and we're proposing without any multifamily, just with the single family, we're proposing 152 additional units of housing to an area that's, you know, at least at this point, it's essentially landlocked, at least from the north and the south, largely from the east. There is a way to snake through Gateway Estates, but because of the pond, it's not a terribly efficient way to do it. So really the only way to get into that neighborhood, whether you're talking about the existing neighborhood or the proposed addition, would be from Tamarack or Hemlock, via cross country, which is why my broader point was having an east-west connection. Once the northern two-thirds of this proposal develops, I think is just so important because I wouldn't want to push that much more traffic through that neighborhood just to get to the northern two-thirds of this. If there's any way that we can find a east-west connection to Highway M, I think that that's an important thing to look at for the future, and I'm satisfied that we can do that based on what Mr. Sarah was saying about the future stormwater detention development and other things developing consecutively with that. So that's kind of what I was trying to get at. The other observation I had was in something that I'd like you to think about. If you look at on your current plan the format of the single family development that's west of the proposed trail. And I guess what I would urge you to consider doing is looking at that type of a lot configuration in terms of the size and so forth. Consider replicating that on the far east end that abuts Gateway Estates. I think that you would likely find existing neighbors in Gateway Estates being much more agreeable to that format of development. I know you don't get as many lots, but at least for the portion that abuts existing backyards of Gateway Estates, maybe consider some larger format lots over there, because I think that probably provides a better transition to that adjacent neighborhood if you do that than the configuration that's there right now.
Thank you, Mr. Manley. Other questions, comments? Mr. Kloss, you have something?
Yeah, I do want to respond to a little bit of the discussion, and it goes back to the ideal position versus practical. If Tony moves ahead with this, he does not want to be limited to developing a third of it. And so when we laid out Kettle Creek to start with, we have a sewer stubbed on Hemlock that's quite deep that can be extended into the northern part and sewer most of it, so that he could develop without being dependent on Midtown. So our hope would be that the city would not limit us to just a third of this, but to let us develop as much of it as we can from a sewer and water standpoint. We may need temporary stormwater in this area that can't be sewered now anyway. But it goes back to my point earlier, we don't know when this is gonna happen. We thought this was gonna happen 10 years ago, and it did not. So we're trying to be as self-sufficient as we can and do as much of this as we can. And really that goes back to the same point about land uses, which is why when Tony and I looked at this, we said, let's put a little bit of everything in here, because we don't know when the rest of the North neighborhood goes. So that was just, again, it's a back and forth. I just wanted to give you that logic of why we even showed it, because Adam was very upfront that it was gonna be a tough sell. But that's why we showed it, to at least get that input and give you our rationale.
Mr. Kloss, it was my understanding as well that you're asking for development of the entire area, and I'm supportive of that as long as our staff indicates that we have the potential to do that.
Yeah, it's gonna take some creative engineering, and we can't develop all of it until the Midtown property goes, but we can do a lot of it.
Yeah, thank you. Other questions or comments? Mr. Horsfall?
Just to comment back to your roadway issue, some of our roads in the neighborhood are collectors, which mean they're, you know, whatever, 66 feet of right-of-way, but they're like Basswood is a nice collector. Hemlock is that, Tamarack is that. Zing is not that. It's a narrower road, and even though we're kind of making it into a collector, and that's, you know, let's kind of move forward. If there's not an east-west connection and all this work is getting done, where's the traffic gonna, the guys who are doing the building, where are they gonna kind of come out of the neighborhood? If we have a connection on Zing, Hemlock, and Tamarack, those are gonna be the main roads that people are gonna come out. And Zing is not really made for that kind of traffic. So again, it's, mm-hmm. You know, when we move forward, I know we're gonna find our own routes, but if I see a lot of traffic on Zing, you know, it's not like Basswood, it's not like Enterprise, where they're built for commuter, you know, type thing. So
if I can respond to that, Jeff, our plans for Zing have been pretty consistent. And then I think the city in their North neighborhood planning may not have looked at that real carefully and showed this. So we just replicated that.
Right.
I think a lot of what you're talking about depends what you are willing to approve to the north, and how that, whether it's direct or not.
Can I follow up?
Go ahead.
So then your east-west road, the mayor talked about a 66-foot wide road, but really that's gonna have to be, you know, wider. That's gonna be like Basswood.
mean, this through the middle?
The one in your neighborhood.
Down here.
Yeah, that's.
Yeah, this is not part of our property.
Right, but even to the west, that has to be sized to be able to handle a lot of traffic going east-west, I would think. It can't be just a normal, you know, 66-foot road like thing is. It has to be something that can handle a lot of east-west traffic. From what, that's my opinion, I guess.
At least, or perhaps just that stretch from Hemlock over? You know, at some point you start dropping off traffic.
It's gonna be, everybody's gonna be coming east-west until the farther one that's north is gonna get built, and that's, we don't know when that's gonna be, so. It's gonna be a very heavy traffic road, so.
Well, we'll look at that as we move forward.
Yeah, thanks.
Other comments, questions? If not, Tony, Ron, we look for. Sir, I know that you wish to speak. This is not a public hearing, and this is really, it's the first, more than willing to talk to you after the meeting, but it's not really a public hearing at this point. There will be opportunities for that, though. I assure you that. Yeah, and you could speak Monday at the council meeting if you'd like. We'll be in the same room at 7 o'clock, and this topic, it will be on the agenda there, but for tonight, there is no public hearing, so sorry about that. We look forward to working with you, and we'll talk to you soon.
Thanks.
Thank you. Next, we are on agenda item 10, which is no action this evening. It is discussion regarding the city's sign ordinance. Mr. Sayre, please.
So at the last Plan Commission meeting, the Plan Commissioners asked that we bring this back on for a future discussion at a Plan Commission meeting. So in your packet was a brief memo from me. I'm also directing you to potentially take a look at the city's website for the sign requirements. I also did include in the packet the code requirements relating to wall and monument signs. I guess before we get into the discussion of this, in 2016, we will be updating our current sign ordinance to bring our ordinance into compliance with a 2015 Supreme Court ruling of Reed versus the Town of Gilbert. That was a ruling that came out from the U.S. Supreme Court that clarified how municipalities can enforce content-based restrictions for signage. So looking at the First Amendment of freedom of speech of how ordinances are constructed to ensure that we are allowing free speech and not limiting it in any fashion. We did have our city attorney provide a review of our sign ordinance, and we do have numerous issues in there that need to be addressed regardless of what direction the Planning Commission wants to go with other changes, but it does need to be just be cleaned up from that standpoint. I did include a summary of the ruling from Brian Ulm. Brian is a professor at the UW and is also an attorney. He did a very brief summary on the Supreme Court ruling and also the opinion that was written by Justice Thomas regarding what type of items we could be taking a look at from a signage standpoint that was content neutral. So every municipality in the country probably has to take a look at this issue sooner than later because there has been some case law that's out there. The Village of Oregon is currently updating their sign ordinance based upon the Supreme Court ruling. So municipalities are looking at it. So I guess the question from staff is obviously we have to do this amendment. And I know this was asked to be placed on the agenda, and it wasn't, I think the request was a little vague, so I was speculating on if it was directed towards monument signage or if it was directed towards wall signage. But I guess the question I guess I'll raise to the Planning Commission immediately is, obviously we have to make this update. Should we just be doing a Band-Aid approach of our current code, bring it up to speed to meet the legal requirements, or as part of that Band-Aid approach, are there certain items in there that you would like to have staff look at as part of that? And I don't know if that relates to wall signage or monument signs, but I guess I'll open it up to the commission to, I guess, clarify on what exactly you'd like to talk about.
Any thoughts on Mr. Sayre's comments? Mr. Manley?
I guess my thought is if we have to crack open the ordinances regulating signs, we might as well take a look and see if there's anything to improve. I think one thing that maybe you could take a look at, Adam, I know from past conversations we've had years ago with Plan Commission, Verona regulates quite specifically the amount of time that text on a digital sign can be displayed before it refreshes or, you know, is replaced with something else. My big complaint with that is that that caused Culver's sign to, you can't even figure out what the flavor of the day is because it takes so long, you know, for them to, you know, cycle through the daily special, the dollar waffle cone or sundae or whatever it is, and then the flavor of the day. And I think it probably does less to protect public safety when you're staring so long trying to figure out, you know, is it my flavor today? but in all seriousness, I think you know, we might be over-regulating there a little bit. And, you know, I'm not saying let's have something that could double as a carnival sign, but, you know, maybe there's a way to add some reason to that part of the ordinances.
I would agree with Mr. Manley that if we have to do a fix, we might as well open up and take a look at the entire thing. So I know we're not prepared to do that this evening, but I would encourage us to have this on the agenda again for the next meeting. But I know you're looking for more feedback. Other feedback, Mr. Lytle, please.
Well, the discussion came up relative to a plan unit development. And I was under the impression, similar to our zoning ordinance, we provide some leeway with the expectation of higher quality or consistent looks for both buildings, side lots, front yards, backyards, all those kind of things in a plan unit development for both where the building sits on the lot and those kind of things, as well as the overall signage for the situation. So it seems like there's a good give and take process that takes place when those are first developed. In the case of Vincenzo, I'm not sure that we, because it had been so long since that had been approved, everything defaulted back to the current standards in terms of signage, and it was just reviewed by staff. But from my perspective, the process by which additional signs or changes to signage in a plan unit development should be consistent with the spirit of the original signage that was approved, and if they're looking for changes or significant additions defaulting to the sign ordinance, then maybe there needs to be an additional layer of review. But I may have misinterpreted that, at least in the case of Vincenzo.
Thank you. Mr. Sarah, please.
Yeah, so Vincenzo is not a PUD. So that is not actually a PUD out there. So the default on that is the existing sign ordinance that we have in place. And when that came forward, I guess for those of you who don't know it, the gas station down there has turned from a BP over to a Citgo station. And as part of that, they added a monument sign at the intersection of Wayland and Old County Highway PB. We worked with the sign company for that one with special consideration with the Citgo signs on the building, out of concern that the background on those being white was going to cast glare up to the apartments and basically across the street to the condos. So we did have those what we call inverted, where you have at night only the red portion of the Citgo lights up and the back white is non-lit. It's more of a dark skies type standard. You see most of the signs along Verona Avenue actually do that as well. They just light the inside of it, not the whole outside panels. But the monument sign there, that was one that, you know, we didn't have a leg to stand on either one of them, but we had less of a case to make on that one, in the sense of this is what the ordinance allows, and The ordinance doesn't talk about any type of base on that, so the base was just what we're trying to get. It doesn't discuss a lot of times putting planting beds around the actual bases, these signs. The ordinance doesn't touch on that as well. So, I mean, those are all areas that I think as staff, we know we do have deficiencies in our current sign ordinance that is probably out of date and maybe doesn't reflect the intentions of what the plan commission would like or the council would like as well. And those items we could take a look at. I think the other question is, you know, does the plan commission want to start reviewing signs as part of the actual development proposals? And I don't know if you want to go there or not, but you know, that is an option as some cities do that, especially in special districts like downtown districts or overlay districts, but you have that option as well too. But yeah, Vincenzo was not a PUD, so that one was just done with our sign code.
Yeah, and I don't think anyone wants to turn this into a 3-volume sign ordinance, but you know, it's been raised to me several times as, you know, they that's seriously in compliance the way they built that, and so people do notice things like that, and if we can find some happy update that doesn't involve a ton more regulations and detail, we sure would be nice.
Yeah, and specifically for monument signs on your screen, this is for multi-tenant commercial buildings. These are the regulations that we enforce. So it's based upon the number of tenants and it's based upon the speed of the roadway. So if you have 2 to 4 tenants in a project and the speed is 35 miles an hour, you get a sign that's 12 feet tall and 72 square feet in area. You know, ultimately the question is that too big? Is that too small? I mean, or is it the fact that the letters on that sign is on a white background and it's blasting 300 feet down the road? I don't know. Maybe that's the issue with that sign, is because at night it does overpower the scale of what's out there. In the day it doesn't do it, but at night, yeah, it's a beacon. Well, this time of night it's a beacon of light. So, but it's all stuff we can take a look at. If you have specific concerns that you think of, I guess send them off to me, and I'll say this is a project that I'm probably not going to get to for a couple months, just due to time constraints from other things. But you know, part of my waiting on that too is the Village of Oregon is currently going through a similar code rewrite, and I'm partially curious on what they come out with in July. They have a very similar zoning ordinance that we have, and I'd kind of like to see what their consultant is preparing, and would like to avoid the going to the consultant route and saying draft this, or going to the attorney route and saying here, draft this as well. If I can use a lot of what Oregon has, I would prefer to do that.
Any other feedback for Adam at this time? If not, Mr. Sarah just said it, so if you have thoughts prior to our next meeting, not that we would be taking any action at the next meeting, but if you have any thoughts, please either call or email Mr. Sarah. Okay, next agenda item, we have reports and comments from Planning Department. Mr. Sarah. Mr. Burns, please.
Yeah, I think as everyone knows, I have accepted another position, so I'm going to be leaving the City of Verona to take a position with the City of Middleton as their finance director. So this is going to be my last Plan Commission meeting here at the City of Verona. I just wanted to say that it's been a great experience over the last 6 years working for the City of Verona, and really appreciate working with all of you and the council members and the mayor and the great staff that we have here. It's certainly been a very good experience, and Verona is a great community, and in large part due to all the efforts that everyone puts in through the volunteers, through the council, and through the staff. Just at a point where I feel like this is going to be a good move for me and my family, and I'm excited about the new opportunity, but it's going to be hard stepping away from this position as well. So just wanted to say thank you to everyone.
Just if I could, you know, Mr. Typical of Mr. Burns, he always thanks everybody else that he works with, but as always, leadership comes from the top, and you've just done a really good job working with all our city staff and with the public and the media and everyone else, and we greatly appreciate that. I know that you attend a lot of the Chamber of Commerce meetings, the IDAC meetings for the school district, and meeting with the other municipalities. And even though, you know, we have Adam here, and Mr. Sarah here, and Mr. Sylvester before that, you've always done a good job of making sure that people are aware of what's going on with planning, future planning for our city as well. So We greatly appreciate everything that you've done for us, and we will miss you. But you're still living in Verona, so.
I'll still be around, yep.
Yeah. So, well, thank you very much, Bill. Yeah. We greatly appreciate that. Any other reports and comments from commissioners? Mr. Horsfall.
Hey, did you put out those public hearing signs next to the buildings by chance?
Mr. Sarah?
No, I have a quote in my email. I'm working with Mr. Reeder on trying to select the sign right now.
Okay.
So it's in the works. We have the sample of kind of what we may go with. Ron and I just need to sit down and talk about logistics of storage, installation, the stuff that goes with it. But yeah, we're getting there. We're close.
Okay. We had a couple public hearings today, and you saw how many people showed up for them. I didn't know if that reflected that you had a sign and no one showed up, or we didn't put a sign and no one showed up. It doesn't make a difference.
No signs right now. So I'm hoping by it won't be in time for the May Plan Commission meeting. My goal is by the June Plan Commission meeting. The public hearings for that one will have signs hopefully in the ground in May.
Great.
That's the goal.
Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Someone asked me today, what is the grading or earth moving work that's going on adjacent to the West End apartment complexes? And I didn't know the answer, so I'll ask the question.
Mr. Sarah?
Yeah, they're constructing permanent stormwater ponds for the apartments and the future development kind of along Roden Avenue. So when that property was sold to the school district, there's temporary ponds actually on the school district's property that were installed way back when the West End was planned as the grandiose, you know, two big boxes and whatnot. So as part of the developer's agreement with the city, they had to construct the stormwater ponds, the stormwater pond in that kind of corner over there. They had to extend a road that would be a cul-de-sac, and they'll also be installing the traffic signals at Westridge and Verona Avenue this year. The pond is the first step. You'll see the road next, and probably traffic signals last.
Go ahead, Mr. Manley.
I'll just follow up on that. As somebody who lives on Westridge Parkway, so we're going to have that's going to be a signalized intersection now, even before they've even had a referendum approved or not approved, whatever the case may be. They don't even have a plan for what buildings they would even put on that property.
That the traffic signal was part of the developer's agreement with Vanta. As part of the original developer's agreement, that was one of the items that was required of them.
I remember that, and that was when that was sort of staged with when you start putting big boxes and stuff in there.
Correct. So as part of that, you know, amended agreement we had with Avanta, it was a requirement to put that in place now. So at least it is in place and doesn't need to be done in the future. And Avanta would be paying for that.
Not happy about another traffic light.
Flashing red.
Other comments from commissioners? Mr. Linder, please.
Yeah, Mr. Sayer, any word on anything happening with the old Chinmi restaurant or the Hughes Flooring is going to end up doing their facade changes that we approved a few months ago?
Mr. Sarah?
Sure. So the Chinmi, the old gas station site, my understanding from speaking with the broker is that deal fell through, and that fell through within the last month here. So it's probably back on the market trying to find a different buyer for that. So yeah, that project isn't going to happen. The Hughes Flooring one, I know they were looking at numbers and talking with the building inspector about pulling permits. I haven't talked to them in a few weeks. I don't know where exactly that is at, but they were talking about trying to get permits pulled on that, but still hasn't happened as far as I know.
No.
Other questions, comments? Mr. Horsfall?
Hey, not to drag it out too long, but how many single family homes do we have? Can you, not tonight, but just for next month's meeting, if you can kind of give us an inventory of, we have 150 out there, or not homes, but lots available. I mean, we heard a lot tonight that we're running out. I don't have a feel for that. So if you just next week or next month.
It's about 180.
Oh.
It's about 180 with the vast majority are in Cathedral Point. You have a handful in Scenic Ridge. You have a couple up in Westridge. You have six for the Rockweiler plat that was approved on Harper. We approved that last year. And that doesn't include the Hometown Grove project, but we about 180, give or take. And that was done a few months ago, but it's probably still pretty close to that.
And how many building permits have we gone through so far in 5 months?
2016, we have 14 single-family permits for new construction of houses.
14?
14, that is down about, I think it's 14. It's down about five or six from last year. Okay. So we're probably going to have a lower number this year just because the only real active subdivision is Cathedral Point. We have zero multifamily and zero, as of today, we have zero multifamily and zero duplex permits that have been pulled. But I would anticipate the third apartment building, Scenic Ridge, is probably coming at some point this year.
Thanks.
Mr. Manley?
Thank you for that. That's good information. Just to make sure I understand, when you're thinking about the big bulk of those single family lots that are available in Cathedral Point, are those all available and online at this point? Or are they part of phased development? I mean, in other words, are the streets and utilities in for all of those lots right now?
No. The short answer is no. So that's counting what is available today and could be built today, but also in counting what we know is coming in a future phase at some point. I do not have the number of how many we have physically today if you wanted to buy a lot or house that would be available. That one I don't have.
Okay, thank you.
I can get it if you would like that.
That might be interesting to know.
Okay.
Anything else? I would just add that Mr. Sarah and I talk just about every day, and he's got a lot of emails and phone calls coming in about potential development. So I see the Planning Commission and the Council being very busy in the upcoming months. A lot of interest out there. With that, I'm sorry, Mr. Horsfall?
Is that why Bill's leaving?
All right, with that, if there's no other business, a motion to adjourn would be in order. We have a motion by Mr. Linder. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Heinzen. All in favor of adjournment signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried, and we are adjourned. We'll see you next month. Thank you, everyone.